Yo, 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 welcome back to another episode of Texas Underground. I am your host, Jay Vaz. And as always, make sure you follow us on all the social media pages at The Jay Vaz Show. And as always, check out the sponsors, La Conecta. Make sure you check them out at shoplaconecta.com. They got the rolling trays for all my smokers. They got the cut energy drink. You can get the custom license plates. They got the north side, the south side license plate. They got the mini plates for anybody out there driving a smart car and whatnot. Then they got the keychains. Make sure you guys check them out at shoplaconecta.com. Use promo code Texas Underground and you get 10% off your order. Man, joining us today, we got a special guest in the building, special guests with the S at the end. And man, Ronnie, give it away. It's an honor to have you in the building, man.
It's an honor to be here.
I got introduced to hip hop by Side Part Mexican, you know. And it just happened you were on the hook on one of the songs. And then you were, the more I dug, you know, started digging into hip-hop, and especially in Houston, you were in everybody's hooks. And, you know, you were everywhere, you know what I mean? So it's an honor to have you on here. As I mentioned, we got legendary Ronnie Spencer in the building. We got Dr. Clemmie, a.k.a. the Cake Lady, in the building. And we're going to be talking about a special event, you know, for the legend himself, man. And we're going to be talking about for March 17th. You guys have the 60th birthday bash coming up. Man. Ronnie Spencer, talk to us. What's going on? What can we expect at this event? And what do people need to know?
Well, I'm going to let the take Kate lady here because she running things. You feel me? And I'm glad to be here with her and also you guys. And I'm glad, you know, my manager is in here with me too also. Two managers. I got one manager here and one manager. You know, Mr. Bishop in the house, Kate lady in the house. But she going to tell you really what's really going on. And then after she get through, then I'm going to let you have a dose of the legendary Ronnie Spencer.
What's up, Houston? It's your girl, Cake Lady, in the house today. Thank you for having me on the show. I just want to shout out to all the people in Houston that follow Ronnie Spencer, that loves Ronnie Spencer, that always show him love. We want to thank you for all your participation and listening to his music, showing up to the shows throughout the years, making music, collaborating with him. You know, we want you to know that we appreciate you guys also. I want to let you know that we are having Ronnie Spencer's 60th birthday bash. It will be lit. So we are expecting you guys to come out. I mean, you know, paint the city green because it will be St. Patrick's Day. Dress to impress. It's an elegant event, and you know how the Cake Lady do it. So it will definitely be elegant. The elegance will be on. So come out and, you know, bring your lady out, you know, mother, sister, whoever. Just come out and have a good time and roll with us. We, you know, we're going to have some underground and we're going to have some, you know, some R&B. It's just going to be a mixing pot of entertainment, if you will. We also will be having a car show, bike show, for low riders, and it will be a competition. So there will be trophies given out, and it will be a $500 giveaway amongst the first and second place. So it will be, you know, $250 for the first place, $250 for the second place. But the first place will get an additional trophy with theirs as well. So we're asking for all the car riders, bike riders to come out and participate in this show. It's going to be lit. We're going to have a great time. It starts at 2 o'clock. It ends at 6 o'clock. And from 6 to 7, we'll be judging. Bring the kids out. There will be a clown, face painting. I guess what you call those things, a jumper thing that they be jumping in. Moonwalks or whatever. So, you know, bring the kids out. They'll have green popcorn, green snow cones, everything green for the kids, right? Yeah. For St. Patrick's Day. So it's just going to be a great time. We're going to kind of like just get together and just have a big old black and brown family reunion.
Nice, nice.
That's what that is.
So it's a family event. Is the family event only from 2 to 6 or throughout the whole night?
Just from 2 to 6 will be the family event. Then we stop in the family event at 6 o'clock, and then we'll do the judging, and then Ronnie Spencer will take his walk at 7:30 in the ballroom. So if you want to stick around for the show, the tickets are $20. They're on Eventbrite for the Ronnie Spencer concert. You're more than welcome to.
And where's the event taking place at again?
8233 Will Clayton Parkway, Humble Civic Center.
I like how you had that memorized. I had to look at my notes. Man. I had that memorized. 60th birthday. What's this feeling like, man? Well, first, you've been in the industry for so long. Out of those 60 years, how many of those years have been in the industry?
Man, it don't feel like 60 to me. I feel like sitting up here right now, I feel like I'm 32.
Yeah.
You feel me? But in my years of this music, I know a lot of celebrities. I've been around the world doing music with, not just people in Houston, but everywhere.
Yeah.
But I'm low key. I just don't, you know, shine like most people shine. I just do me. You feel me? And
yeah.
That's what it is.
Yeah. And the reason I'm asking is because, again, been in the game for so long, the love that you continue to get from people, obviously now your daughter's getting that love too. You know, she's built her own career as well. And it's got to be an amazing feeling to see how much people, you know, follow you and love your craft, which doesn't come easy because we're in an industry where people forget about you quick.
Yeah.
And they move on to the next.
Yes. And I thank God that they didn't forget about me. You feel me? And like I say, all the fans and all the artists and musicians and producers I work with all gave me love, you know, and I gave them love back. And they just like to hang around me, I guess, because I'm a humble guy. I don't really trip or do all the, you know, extra stuff. I just do music and try to make the best of it. And my goal is to let everybody in the world love my music and like my music and play my music and enjoy it. So that's what I do it for. I do it for the people, my fans, and the world.
Yeah, that's, again, whenever Mike hit me up and he's like, hey, how would you like to have the Cake Lady and Ronnie Spencer on the show? I'm like, why are you even asking me this? Like, let's do it, bro. Like, why are you even asking? So obviously, you know, you're his manager.
I am. I'm one of his managers.
One of his managers.
Right.
And how exactly did this connection come about, and how does the Cake Foundation have a part into Rodney Spencer's career, I guess you can say?
So basically, it's twofold. So I'm the Cake Lady because I have a business in Acres Home called Cajun Heat and Bakery Suite, and we cater and we do a lot of your Hennessy cakes, Tennessee whiskey cakes, German chocolate cakes, etc. And coming from a club background, as an entrepreneur, selling your products, going out as a vendor, hustling and grinding, I moved into the world of entertainment as a promoter. So, you know, shaking hands, rubbing elbows with a lot of people in entertainment, I just transitioned over. And then when I met Ronnie Spencer, it's just like, it was like a glove fitting on your hand tight. It was just like, it was a fit, you know. Personality match, charisma match, elegant match. There's just a lot of great things that match that I seem to believe that I could really make a difference in his career.
Yeah.
In supporting him. He have a lot of good background already with the R&R group. His daughter come from a lot of strong, I mean, it's just a lot of strength of music. So I'm just another asset to the team, and I'm very grateful to be here that he actually saw something in me where he wanted to collaborate and work with me. But doing events is something that I've always done on the private sector, and then I moved into the public sector. So the Birthday Cake Wedding Foundation is a 501c3 nonprofit. So that's something totally different from the Cake Lady. It's just that we have the birthday name inside of our name. The birthday means we're celebrating the fact that we're born. We're celebrating the fact that we didn't die from COVID. We're celebrating the fact that we have another chance at this thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And the wedding is we're going to commit. It's the commitment to our life. It's the commitment that just the fact that you having me here today, that's a commitment.
Yeah.
It's a commitment in everything we do. So it's the Birthday Cake Wedding Foundation. It's what we're about. That's how we roll.
Yeah. I'm so glad you said the whole, you know, we're still alive. We're here, even though the whole COVID thing. In 2001, I had COVID like 3 times. Well, according to them,
wow.
I don't know.
Man.
But I was in the hospital. Wow. I was in the hospital. And it's one of them things where I think I appreciate life even before that.
Mm-hmm.
But it got to the point where after that happened to me, you appreciate it even more.
Absolutely.
And I remember telling my brothers and them, like, I'm gonna have a big birthday party this year because I was in a hospital. And when I first went in there, like, I couldn't breathe. And then they do a CAT scan. And again, this was primetime COVID, so you couldn't really do too much in the hospitals.
Mm-hmm.
And they tell me, hey, 90% of your lung is covered in something. We're assuming it could be lung cancer.
Mm-hmm.
as soon as they tell me that, I'm like, bro, what kind of sick joke is this? Like, right. How's my mom going to handle this? First my dad, now me.
Right.
Like,
that's going to be hard.
Yeah. So within the 5 months, they finally got me into the hospital 5 months later to do the whole tube down your throat crap to get a sample of what's going on. And it was just COVID damaging my lung, where it damaged 90% of it. So you start looking at life a little bit different, and you're right. It's a birthday that, hey, we're still here.
Right.
We're still able to do what we love with people that we care about. And it just feels good. It just feels good.
It feels good. I was on fire to do something. I was like, if he just give me that chance. I did all the education. I stayed drug-free. I'm like, I done all those things. But living, birthing the life into your dreams or something that just really makes you happy, make you feel like you're making a difference on the planet, needed to get that done.
And you said it's a nonprofit, so what else do you guys do for?
We fundraise for different events for autism awareness, for sickle cell anemia, for Down syndrome. We just had an event called the Tex-Mex Southern Soul. That was December the 30th. We gave back to autism, and we also did a food drive for the Houston Food Bank. So as a nonprofit, we donate to other organizations to make a difference. We go out and we volunteer. We did the Christmas thing with Tex, with Infamous Tex, with Hustle Time.
Shout out Hustle Time.
At the church. So we just out here just trying to make a difference.
Yeah. That's awesome. It's and again, you guys can check them out. We'll put the links on the description of the video, description of the podcast, where you can find them on social media and be able to become part and try to help any way they can. Mm-hmm. If somebody does want to help, how can they reach out to you or how can they?
Sure, no problem. You can go to @thebirthdaycakew, and the W is for wedding, so don't put wedding, just put the W, The Birthday Cake W Foundation on Instagram. You can inbox me. You can also text me at 346-288-9617 and just put in the subject line autism, the word autism, and I'm going to know that there's someone who wants to support what we do.
Awesome. And this is the event happening on March 17th. We're going to get a little bit ahead of the schedule here, but we'll talk about September 14th. It's another event you were talking about, 50 Shades of Green. Can you talk to us about what you guys are planning for that as of right now?
50 Shades of Green is one of my first projects where I wanted to do something for the culture. So basically, I'm merging the Hispanic culture with the African-American culture, and I know that they have a lot of music of similarity, but I wanted to introduce the genres, not just about just networking with us because we're different nationalities, but also the music. We want to merge the music, collaborating music. So Southern Soul, you know, if you think about a lot of the background of the Hispanic culture, you think about the Alamo. You think about real cowboys. Okay, well, we got real cowboys in the African-American community that have, trail rides and everything. So why don't we, you know, be cowgirls and cowboys together, you know what I'm saying, and do great things. And so I wanted to bring something that I can honor the Houston legends. I can honor the artists that's out here, letting them know, hey, we see you. You're doing a wonderful, wonderful job, and we would like to honor you today just to give you something, just a token of appreciation, just a pat on the back to say, hey, keep doing what you're doing. So we did Youngster. We did Daryl Scott. We honored a lot of people at the Tex-Mex Southern Soul. We had Misery, H-Town Mexicano, Infamous Tex. It was his birthday. We did
Valero from the ghetto.
We did. We honored all these people on our platform December the 30th for the Tex-Mex Southern Soul. So same thing with the 50 Shades of Green, Black Market Extravaganza. It's no different. We're bringing in film and television. So we're going to have a panel for film and television, as well as for directors, producers, and music. So it's going to be twofold. And we're going to bring people in that can talk to them and train them and tell them different things. Then we'll open it up for newcomers to get on the platform and show their stuff.
Yeah.
And then we'll have those old schools to tell them, hey, you're good at this, you're good at that, critique it, give them a little bit of feedback so they'll have something when they leave. And then the second day we'll have a grand ball, a big old grand ball. So it's going to be a two-day event, but they'll leave with a lot of joy. They'll leave with information. They'll leave with being able to perform. They'll leave with just they're going to be full from the event.
I love that, because the other day I had a Viva Mezcal from California. And they do this once a year as well. Mm-hmm. And I had said, like, he asked me, he's like, do y'all do this in Houston? It's like, I don't think so. But now that you're saying, I feel goofy as hell. Because everything you're telling me, it's yeah. like you guys do so much for the community. Because, mm-hmm. you know, their idea is there's a lot of artists or kids that like music, but don't know how to write mm-hmm. or don't know how to
articulate it.
Correct. How to put together the song, you know.
And they may be gifted by ear
yeah.
and by sound, but don't know how to do the other part.
Yeah. Correct. Right. So to hear that this is something that you guys are going to be doing, and given that criticism that is much needed sometimes, because when it comes from somebody that, you know, myself, that's not a legend, people might take it as you're hating. But it's like, no, I want you to get better. Mm-hmm. And you're only going to get better if I tell you, hey, you're lacking here, like your delivery's off.
They don't understand that what you're doing is just giving constructive criticism. It's not hating. It's to try to get you better. It's to give you that push.
Correct.
Shout out to Harvey Love. We're going to have Harvey Love as one of the judges on the panel that's going to be able to critique. He does producing, and he's an artist himself. So we'll have him and people of a like of him that's going to be able to give these guys real information. You know, real information, not just something they can go read in a book. It's easier to hear it from someone who's been there, that Correct. Knows.
Yes, like K. Reno.
Yes,
people like C. Like Reno. People like, you know, Yonks itself, or Flip, you know. Mm-hmm. You can name so many. Believe it or not, ESG. He taught me a lot when we was on the same label. But what she's speaking about is real, mm-hmm. you know, because a lot of people do need help in the industry when they're trying to come up in this ball game. Because just like you said earlier, this music thing changes. It changes every day. So if you ain't on your game, or you don't have somebody to teach you, show you, try to help you get where you need to be to reach your goal, you're going to be in trouble.
Correct. Correct. So yeah, it's definitely something we need, and I'm glad. And this one is not March 17th. March 17th is Ronnie Spencer's 60th birthday. The event that we're currently talking about is for September. We're just getting a little bit ahead of ourselves, but we'll get more into that when the time gets closer. Nah, Rodney.
man,
it's I can't emphasize how much of an honor it is to be able to do this interview with you. That's why I was like, can we talk about it now? Or can you come sit down later?
Man, we can talk to the lights go off. I don't have a problem with it.
So for anybody that's watching, and for some, you know, I do get a lot of the younger crowd that tunes into my shows because of the OTs and stuff like that, the Mexican OT, shouts out. And they might not be familiar with Ronnie Spencer, so let me just give you guys a quick story who Ronnie Spencer is. Ronnie has worked with a lot of legendary Houston artists, and he's a legend himself. He's worked with people like Kiki, obviously Zero, Flip, Screw, Fat Pat, a lot of in the Hispanic community, Juan Gotti. You got a song with Juan Gotti that people love, Fear No Evil, I believe was the name of it. Obviously with SPM, Lucky Luciano, the list goes on. The list goes on. So it goes back to the whole black and brown. And for somebody that's watching that might not know why I'm so excited about it, that's why I'm excited about it, because it's, I was like 14, 15 years old when I got introduced to hip-hop, and I'm 36 now, and it's dope to have legends come and take the time to talk to me, because I would have never thought at 14 years old that I'd be sitting down with any of you guys and having these conversations, you know what I mean? So I guess we'll start from the very top. Ronnie Spencer, did you always know you could sing? Was this something that you always knew you were gifted?
Well, when I was young, I would go around the house singing Marvin Gaye and singing Al Green. And my brother, he used to listen to the Osley Brothers. And his favorite Osley Brother album was 3+3. And that's the one that just kind of pretty much shocked the world. You know, Ron Osley's first platinum and gold hit was Scream and Shout, Shout. And that took his career on. And so my brother was a big, big fan. And he turned me on to the Osley Brothers. He said, you know what? You need to listen to this. I think you can sound like this guy, you know. And I was young. I said, okay, I'll try. So I tried it. And sure enough, I sounded like him. So that's what got me in really into singing is my brother, my sisters, my other brother. We used to all, back in the day, when my mom would go to work, we would always get in the living room, and we'd move the couches and flip couches up and down and make a stage, and we'd start trying to sing. You know, we get pots and pans and we start trying to sing, and I would always be the one to stand out to start singing. But my oldest brothers play drums, and he taught me how to play drums, and that's my first instrument that I ever learned how to play. And back in the game, my mom and them used to have a group, and they used to work at 4212 Alameda, Mitchell's Lounge on Alameda. And they used to always, you know, play. And one day she told me, she said, you know, your daddy wants you to bring the drums over and play with him, because he played a B3 Hammond organ. So I did, and come over there, and he was like, man, this dude played, my son played good, you know. So, and it took off. So when I left, it just, something hit me, you know. I said, you know what, I'm going to take it serious. So I started singing. Started singing in church, started singing. So that's when I realized that I can sing.
I'm that guy.
When I got a little, yeah, right. I got a little older, I end up DJing at Alameda Skating Ring. And I would sing the Osley Brothers, and this one female used to pay attention to me. And I called her one day, she was just staring at me. So she come in the booth, she say, that's not Ronnie Osley, you singing this song. And I just say, shh, you can't tell nobody, because I'm nervous now, and you can't tell nobody. So I know if she know, she didn't tell some people. So, and she surely did. The next Sunday, man, I go to the skating ring, and I'm forgetting. And I played the Osley Brothers, and I just start singing. And next thing I know, everybody stopped skating. I don't realize it then. I look at them, where everybody's staying? I'm going hard up there on the mic. And they start clapping. I said, oh, man, she didn't tell everybody in the skating ring.
Everybody knows now.
So now, I'm at home. I say, you know what? What I'm gonna do? So, well, this artist by the name of Al D is really the one that really discovered me in the hood, and he used to always tell me, say, when I do my album, I'm putting you on the album, man. I got the hook road. I got everything. And I thought he was playing. I said, oh, you playing? But it wasn't. He knew I used to shoot basketball, so he sent Jam Down Records to the basketball court. And these two guys got out by the name of Vince and Pat. And they say, Ronnie, we need to talk to you. So everybody looking at me, and they're like, what's going on, man? I said, nah, I don't know what's going on. He say, well, we need to put you on a song. I said, a song? He said, yeah. I said, what song? I said, man, y'all playing? He said, no. And he said, I'll tell you what, if you have time today, and he went in his pocket and he got out $3,000. He said, I'll give you $1,000 to get on this hook. So I told all the guys on the basketball, hey, man, I got to go, man. So I jumped in the limo. Sure enough, he take me to Jam Down Records. I go to Jam Down Records, and who no better than Al D. He said, man, you came. He said, come on, man, let's go and knock this out. So I was kind of nervous because this was my first song I ever did professional. So I'm in the studio. So the name of the song was called Riding on Vols. So I got in there and did the song and did what I had me doing. And I looked around, everybody was screaming and jumping in the studio. So I'm like, what is going on? Mm-hmm. So I said, man, you done, man. You paid. I'm going to call you tomorrow. We're going to mix the song. I said, okay. So Al called me the next day. And sure enough, the song was nice. And it took off. And what that did was it made UGK hear the song. So when UGK heard the song,
Peter Pimp,
yeah.
Old Screw called me and said, hey man, UGK man wants you on a song. Can you come to the studio? I said, yeah, I'll come over there. So I came. And sure enough, Pimp C was in there. And he's looking at me. You know, he had Pimp look at our little glasses. Like, is that him? So Screw said, yeah, that's my guard there. He said, man, ain't him. He look like he work on a transmission. He said, no, man, that's him. So I said, okay. So he said, you the one sound like the Osley Brothers? I said, that's what they say. He said, well, I got a song. He played the song off the Live It Up album called Girl Ain't I Been Good to You. Well, I was already familiar with all the Osley Brothers' work because that's all I started listening to. And I said, yeah, I know that song. So they played the song. And he said, can you do a hook to it? I said, yeah. What you want to do? He said, the name of the song going to be One Day. I said, okay. He said, man, I'm going to go to the store, just kind of play around with it. So he went to the store. When he come back, the song was dead. I had already did the hook, everything. And Skip said, man, you're not going to believe it. Skip Holman's studio out there in Katy is where we, you know, recorded. And he played it. And Pimp them, they just went crazy over it. I said, man, that's it. We don't need to do nothing else. And by the time he got ready to go out the door, he stopped. He said, wait a minute, let's change one thing. I said, what is that? He said, Study, you just said one day you're here, the next day you're gone. I want you to say, fool, one day you here. I said, okay. So I went back and changed it, and boom. Next thing I know, it was platinum and gold.
Can you refresh your mind what it sounded like?
Don't give him a little bit.
Fool, one day you here, and then you gone. Yeah. 'Cause one day you here, baby, and then you gone. One day you here, baby, and then you gone. And that's how it come out, and man, it's what it was, you know. And
after look, that, my brother like gonna love this clip. He's the one that put me in UGK. That was one of the first songs that he showed me. So so he gonna love this clip for sure. You mentioned Screw bringing you out there. How did that relationship with Screw come about?
Well, me and Screw was DJs. It was back then. It was me, Screw, and a bunch of us. We was DJs, and we would always, you know, play music and mix. You know, Screw knew how to mix, but he didn't know how to blend R&B with hip hop. I was playing R&B and hip-hop at the skate ring, so I showed him how to blend R&B and hip-hop together. So he took it to another level. And when he did, it just blowed up, and he called me. He said, hey, man, I want you to come over here and hear this. So I went over there. So he had took some R&B, and he took some hip-hop, and he had blend them. And it was jamming. But Screw took it to another level because when he played it, he slowed it down on the 1200s. But then he put it back in a tape machine and slowed it down again, so it gave it that real slow feel. Now with the R&B and the hip-hop together, the bass was just incredible, so it made a different effect on the tape. So when them guys put it in their cars, it was just stupid. It was just, you know, something that you're like, only thing you can do is just bob your head to it, you know. But I give shout-outs to Robert Earl Davis. He was one of the best.
R.I.P.
But the first person ever screwed a Screw tape was Mr. Daryl Scott. And he's still incredible.
Shout out to my boy Daryl Scott.
He's still incredible with it. Yes. And, you know, I always let people know, you know, Daryl Scott was screwing music before any DJ out here. But when Screw got his shot at it, he just screwed up the whole world to me.
It's not looking back.
And, yeah, you know, both of those guys is creative, mm-hmm, and they geniuses. They just for their time, so... And I DJed with both of them, so that's how that came about.
Yeah, the Screw era was crazy to me. This, you know, I was born in Mexico, grew up in McAllen, right across the border. When I came to Houston, I first heard Screw. I didn't understand it. I was like,
oh, you had to be high. You had to be drunk.
Yeah, I was like, bro, why you want to fall asleep? Like, what's going on?
It's like when when they say when you drink a beer or something, or you drink some gin and juice, you lay back.
No.
You lay back. So when you lay back, the song is going slow, but you can hear what all the rappers are saying.
Yeah. And my friends used to tell me, like, nah, bro, this is it. And I was like, I just don't get it. I don't get it. And they're like, nah, you tripping. You need.
Now, when you got drunk, did you like it?
It changed the vibe, and then it started to understand. I was like, man, this man changed Houston culture.
He changed the game.
For sure. Yeah. For sure. And then one of the reasons I like talking about history on my show and talking about Houston history specifically, as we get older and new generations start to come out, some of them feel like they can change history. Not long ago, there was this girl on TikTok, and nothing against the girl, you know, younger generation, probably just out of ignorance. Mm-hmm. So I'm not attacking her. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying the reason I like talking about history is because she was talking about Slow and Reverb, the first to ever do it, DJ whatever, can't remember the guy's name. And it was like, what is Slow and Reverb? And she plays the track, and I was like, oh, hell no. This is definitely Chopped and Screwed. Like, right. And again,
yeah,
they're
calling it that. I noticed that.
They're calling
Where
it that.
Where did that come from?
I think New York, if I'm correct.
Okay.
So it compliments to Screw how much his, you know, legacy has lived on to where it's getting his win outside of Texas.
Way outside of Texas.
And it's influencing the younger generations. But we also need to talk about the history because this is where it started.
Exactly.
And he's the creator. This is where it started. He's the one that blew it up. So let's not just get crazy and start giving other people credit. Like that's we're not gonna do that either. But being that you've been on so many records, right? So many records with so many artists. With I don't mean to put you in the spot or anything, but which is the most memorable record for you? Even if it's two or three of them,
it would be One Day. One Day was like an anthem, cause it's true. One day you're here, and next day you're all gone. Mm-hmm. You feel me? So it's. I get called for that song for funerals, weddings, ballrooms, you know, all the time. And I kind of feel kind of awkward when they call me and say, man, you know, my brother died. One Day was his favorite song. Can you sing it at the funeral? And here's a guy standing in front of you. You see his pain and you see his emotions. And it's kind of like you can't tell him, hey, man, I can't sing that in the church. But at that point, you looking at these people, his family, I just say, yeah. And when I sing it, the whole church just, like, they consider it like it's a gospel song. So I just sing it, and 9 out of 10, they want it a cappella. They don't want it with the music. They want to hear me say the first part of that song. So with this song being what it is today and when it came out, to me, it's like it's been revamped for the younger generation because a lot of the young generation and people in the world still think it's Ronna Isley. You feel me? So when I get on stage to sing it sometime, that's when they kind of like be looking at me. And when I get off the stage, I got a lot of young people, a lot of old people, a lot of middle-aged people coming to me wanting an autograph because the first thing they tell me, man, I thought that was Ronna Isley all these years. You feel me? They even did it at the 50 Shades of Green. Mm-hmm. They even did it at this last show we just
Text
did.
Makes up Text. So.
When I got off the stage, first thing, I had a lot of older people, middle-aged people and young, say, man, I thought that song was Ronald Isley's, which the song is sampled off of the Live It Up album from Ronald Isley, but I sung it different. So it's like, this song is kind of like when they sing for the Super Bowl, that song, they Star Spangled Banner. This is what this song is.
Anthem.
And it's a lot of people, and they still playing it to this day.
Yeah.
You know, I see younger people, older people, middle-aged people play this song.
Yeah.
So it got to the place where I didn't want to sing it no more, you know, because this is what people remember Ronnie Spencer of his One Day. Ronnie Spencer got a lot of songs. So every time I get ready to do a show date, dad or something to play or get with a band, that's the first song they say, we'll play. And I had band people tell me, we'll play, but you got to sing One Day. I said, okay. Do a show, but you got to do One Day. They don't look at So Real or All About My Dough or Peeping Me or Ball Caps or any of those songs, beautiful songs that I did with Rec Shop and other people. They don't say nothing about them songs.
Yeah.
Long as I can sing One Day, they all right. And then when they hear the show, I say, man, I know you did that song. Man, I know you did that song. I say, it's a lot of songs I did. It's a ton of them. And that's just how it's been in my career for as music goes. And that's the first, even when they meet me in the studio, first thing they do is start singing One Day.
And it's got to be a great feeling that, like you said, obviously, in sad times when people want it for a funeral or whatever, but it's got to be a good feeling that the song meant that much to them and the family knew that hey, could you do it one more time for them before we finally say goodbye? So that's going to be a great feeling, I feel like. Another good feeling, I would think, and this one's on a more of a positive note, your daughter. Talk to us about that. Talk to us about the feeling of seeing your daughter doing her thing out here.
Well, I knew my daughter was going to sing when her mama had her. Because when she come out, she didn't do the normal baby cry. She hit a note. And her note was, she just held it. It's like when she come out, it was like, ah, before she started crying. Yeah. So I run out the emergency room. I said, oh, my daughter going to be a singer. My daughter, everybody looking at me, you crazy. I said, man, my daughter going to be a singer, man. That was a note. And my brother and them filmed it. And they showed it. And everybody said, you know, he right. Mm-hmm. She started crying after that note. And believe it or not, she did the Barre Baby at 6 years old.
I just learned that when you did the Ronnie Houston interview. Mm-hmm. I learned that that was her.
That was her. A lot of people think it was a sample, but nope. That's actually, we also recorded that at Skip Holman's studio in Katy, and we had to sit some stools up and put a couple of pillows so the mic can reach her. And she was so off the chain till I was like, do I have to come in here and show her? My daughter at 6 years said, no, Daddy, I got it. And so Noak D looked at me. I looked at Noak D and D-Rick and all of them guys. Like, so Skip said, just let her take it. So Noak said, I'm gonna show you the words and I'm gonna write it down. And he say, it's the Barre Baby, the Barre Baby, the Barre Baby. That's what I want you to say. She said, okay, I got it. So she told Skip Holman, oh, you can go on and play it. So he played the track. When she did it in her own flavor. We didn't tell her to say, Barre. We didn't tell her to do that. It just came out, and it was on time, and it was on note. So they start looking at me, and I'm looking at them. So Skip said, just let her sing. Mm-hmm. And they took so many takes that people haven't even really heard that. And when they put it together, it was just like, and she's up there like that, you know. I used to do this when I sing. I beatbox when I sing, and I don't know it. Only one that caught this was two producers, and that was Noak D and Blue Note. They the only one that caught that. And people used to look at them and tell them, say, man, you lying. He said, man, that man beatbox when he sing. I don't know I'm doing it. Well, my baby was doing the same thing. That's what really let me know she's singing, because she kept her tempo. And she would do her head, and that was her tempo. And yeah, it was right. And that's how she started, and it just blowed her up. So she was a mega superstar at six. So my daughter had to reinvent herself, because people still thinking she that little girl.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm seeing a lot of people on the internet singing the Barre Baby and that type of stuff. And we don't get mad at that, because we look at it like, it's promotion, it's marketing, and they love a song. It's a true fan, so we let the true fans live their dream. We don't crush them. A lot of people get mad at, hey, I want to sue because they didn't get permission. I don't deal with all of that. That's drama. I feel if a person sample Ronnie Spencer, which they have, and they play our music, it's just love. It's, to me, it's free marketing, it's love, and I love it. So I don't even bother them. I just let them do them. You know, and my daughter's pretty much the same way, you know. So I know a lot of people that have did One Day Over, and I know a lot of people have did the Barre Baby over. Yeah. So me and my daughter, we kind of pretty much just laugh about it and go on about our way. But now she is a different character when it comes to singing. My daughter can do 10-part harmonies, you feel me? And she do opera, and she can change her voice in so many different ways. Her rapping ability is incredible. Where she learned her wordplay, I can't tell you, because she didn't get it from me. But her wordplay is phenomenal. I have rappers asking Ronnetta to write their album. Major labels is letting Ronnetta write they major artists' albums. That's how cold she is with a pen. Yeah. Her deliverance is real wicked and stupid, but she got a sexy feel behind it. You feel me? The way she doing, she worked real quick. She worked real quick in the studio. I can still be on trying to figure my hook out. Ronnetta did three or four of them and sung them and be looking at me and said, Daddy, you all right? And now she's teaching me things. So that's incredible. And I love her to death. And I love her for what she's doing and what she took up where I left off.
Yeah.
And I think right now she is one of the coolest in the industry, not just Texas, because there's a lot of cold people in Texas. It's a lot of brilliant rappers and females and males in Texas. But my daughter is one of the coldest. And I just want to let everybody know Miss Ronnetta Spencer is off the change.
Ronnetta, shouts out to Ronnetta Spencer. The other day, who was I interviewing? I was interviewing the guys from Shut 'Em Down, Sin and Big C.
And,
the Mexican Sin.
Oh, Mexican
Sin. Shut Them Down Records.
Right.
Okay. And she came up, and I'm trying to, on top of my head, and I said, I called her Ronnetta Stone. And then she reposted it on Facebook, and she put laughing my ass off. It happens often. I said, man, I apologize. Honest mistake. But obviously, she didn't take it a bad way or anything. She's like, it happens a lot. I was like, I'm thinking on the spot, and I'm like, oh, y'all did that song, Ronnetta Stone. And then they're like, Spencer. I was like, you get it. I'm like, you know who I'm talking about. Shouts out to Ronnetta. And so, 2024, we're barely in February. Obviously, March 17th, we got the 60th birthday bash. What else can we expect this year? Is there new music coming?
Yes, I'm working on and mastering a lot of stuff now. I had to rebuild my studio, but everything is good thanks to my manager. You know, he is really helping me get a lot of things together for this new project. If it wasn't him, I don't know what probably would have happened. But, you know, God sent him to me, man. He's been phenomenal for us, making sure that the studio is running, making sure that are mastering new music and doing new music. And that's the stage we at right now. We picking, I have probably, I'm gonna say probably about 600 or 700 songs recorded. And right now I'm just going through the ones that I need to do because I gotta do an R&B album for the ladies and for the men, and I have to do a hip hop R&B album because when I did the first R&B album, hip hop fans got mad at me because I didn't do a hip hop album. So this time I'm gonna do a hip hop album, hip hop R&B album, and I'm gonna do an R&B album. So I'm gonna drop one on Friday and I'm gonna drop one on Saturday and just let them have it. And I think I owe it to them. I'm way overdue. So yes, that's what I'm working on.
And do we have a title for them yet?
I might call one of them Hold On and the other might just be The Legendary 2. So I don't know yet, but I'm still going through because I did a song with Rona Osley and that's going to be on one of the albums. So,
that's awesome.
You know, be looking out for that. It's nice. It's
I try to keep the history part short so I don't take too much light away from the event itself. But hopefully we'll have a part two to where we can sit down and dig deep into the history of Ronnie Spencer. That'll be awesome. But just a quick recap of the event, March 17th, 8233 Will Clayton Parkway in Humble, Texas. Once again, hit them. What can they expect one more time? Just the quick rundown.
Oh, God. It's going to be so many activities from the hours of 2 o'clock to 6 o'clock. We're going to have a car show, a bike show. The red line, the white line, the blue line, the green line, every line. We're telling you to come on out and join this show. There will be a cash giveaway for the first and second place, as well as a trophy for the first place and cash. So it's just going to be a great show. And then we're getting everyone prepared for the elegant birthday bash for Ronnie Spencer. We're going to have people that's performing like Kay Reno, Kirk O'Bangs, Ronnetta Spencer, Andre Seville. It's just going to be a slew of celebrities in the house. So you might want to show up and show out at the 60th birthday bash for Ronnie Spencer. And
March
of course,
17th.
It's St. Patrick's Day, right?
Correct.
So we're going to paint the city green.
Right.
Yeah, and Ronnie, of course, Ronnie's in concert. It's all about Ronnie.
It's all about
he's
Ronnie.
He's shutting it down. He's closing it out with the Ronnie Spencer concert. So if you want to see his concert, just come on out. It's going to be wonderful. It's going to be something amazing to see. So bring your cameras.
Make sure you guys pull up more.
So I just want to, you know, I want to give a shout out to all my producers that work with me. It's a lot of them out there. Little Rock, Big Rock, Blue Note, Sinclair, Harvey Love, Double D, Chicken Hawk, Note D. So many producers that I work with. Fletto from the Ghetto, Bouillon. Just so many of them. It's so many producers and band members. I just want to give a shout out to them. Hope they show up. Funky Fingers, Corey, Barrel Wolf, N.O. Joe, Crazy C. You know, I work with all the radio staff, Mad Hatter, T. Gray. I mean, all of these. You'd be surprised of the people that I've did music with And I just want to take this time out, since it's my 60th birthday, to let everybody know in H-Town, I love them. If I missed your name, I didn't mean it, because there's so many people, all the rappers, all the lady rappers. Thank you for being a part of Ronnie Spencer and R&R Entertainment. I want to thank everybody in the world, people, Ron Osley, Angela Winbush. It's just so many people
Janet
that I can
Jackson.
Name. Janet Jackson. I mean, you can. I can go on and on.
List
you know?
Goes on.
Yeah, the Ghetto Boys, Scarface,
everybody,
all of them. It's just so many.
And then we don't want to forget the team that's going to be helping put this together. We have I have members in my organization, and one of them is called Angel Unique Designs Creation. So they will be in the building. So we want to shout out to Angel. He makes all of my events top elegant. I come in and create the vision. I tell him what I'm looking for and what I want. I could just see any empty building, and I can walk in and just, hey, this is what it's going to look like. And then he put it together. I'm really grateful for having a solid team. Shout out to Albert Bonneby from Al B Productions. He's been a great support for me as well. Man Cave, you know, Victor Bello, you know, Vernon Washington with Steel Street Magazine. We all are like a family, and we do great work, and we collaborate together. And so they're excited about being a part of this Ronnie Spencer Birthday Bash. They're working hard. I mean, they're putting flyers out there. They're doing it. They're making the calls. They're doing the connections. So I can't. Although I am a manager for Ronnie Spencer, and I do a lot of legwork, groundwork, I'm only one person. It takes a team. Have you ever heard the saying, it takes a village?
It takes a village.
It's almost like it's like that. You know, you have to learn how to network, collaborate, and bring in other people's ideas, you know? So this is what it's about. It's a great collaboration.
It's a business. You can't run. I'm gonna tell everybody in the world, you can't run a business by yourself.
Right.
You need a legal team, and you need a good team that you can trust to handle some of the things that you're gonna handle. And I want to also give my family thanks, because they're gonna be coming out, and it's kind of like a family reunion for me this time. I want to thank Nelson. I want to thank Daryl, Don, Noble Jr., Lisa, Noblette. I want to thank, you know, my brother's kids, Nina, Sheena, Bonnie, Little Richard, Rawton. Yeah, man. I want to thank Nikhil. She's the secretary of the company.
Shout out to Nikhil.
Rachel Cook. She's a part owner of the label that I got. I got to thank Mr. Bishop, is my personal manager that's been sticking with me through thick and thin. And it's a lot of people. Lionel Taylor with AT&T Food Company. All of these people that's coming here for this event. My phone has been blowing up, and it's really a good feeling to see your whole family and friends get together and make this happen. I couldn't have did it without the cake lady, Bishop, and my immediate family. You know, I love you, Rachel. I love you, Nikhil. I love you, Richard and Ralton. And, you know, people's coming all out of town for this event that's calling me, you know, every day, you know. So I just want to thank you too, Mo, for being there. It's just so many people. You know, I just want to give them thanks and let them know that I hope everybody come out and we have a good time and show up and pour up for the 60th
birthday
party. I'm glad I made it. You feel me? Because it's a lot of my partners that's not here today that didn't make 60. So I just want everybody to realize that's what it is.
So make sure you guys pull up March 17th. We're going to be celebrating a real legend, a Southern OG. Once again, the address is 8233 Will Clinton Drive in Humble, Texas. Rodney Spencer's 60th birthday bash.
And I just want to say to everybody, don't forget about Hustle Town. Tune in to Hustle Town Network.
Man,
they are also helping promote this event. So shout out to Infamous Text, 97.9 The Box. Everybody who is taking part of this show that will be out, Hustle Town will be in the building. So I just want to shout out to Hustle Town Network.
Shout out Hustle Town Network.
Also to Magic 102.
KG Smooth.
KG Smooth, what's up, buddy?
Shots out. So once again, pull up March 17th. Thank you guys for stopping by. It was definitely an honor to have you by. It's definitely an honor to know more about your business and everything you do behind the scenes.
Thank you.
So thank you guys for tuning in. Drop a comment. Let us know how you feel about the interview. And we'll probably have a part two coming soon. March 17th, pull up. And September 14th, mark your calendars. Don't forget about September 14th as well. And you're watching Texas Underground.
One more thing I want the world to realize. The new movie coming out with JB and SMG, Once Upon a Time in the H, is coming. It's going
to
be released.
To you. Yes.
So y'all get prepared for that. I'm in the movie. It's so many awesome people going to be in that movie. JB, I think you did an awesome job with all your staff and the producers. I just want to let y'all know that movie is coming out, and it's a lot of people is playing big roles in it. So.
And before we go, tell Go-Toast to pull up. Let
Go-Toast. Well, yeah, man, you need to pull up, man. We need to do that song we did, man. We got to do that song, man. Pull up, man. I know you're busy, man, but I'm at your spot right now, so you need to pull up so we can do
In My World.
Who missed it, why don't you give them a little close-out hook right quick from One Day You're Here right quick.
One Day?
Oh, yeah.
We got to do it. Let me drink some water because that's the touch of time. Ronnie Spencer got a little cold.
We know that some of you guys might have missed it, so we just want to leave and give you a little taste of my artist, how he get down right quick.
Well, this is for all the players that's got their ball caps and tennis shoes, and all the players that got, it's all about their dough, so this is what it is. Fool, one day you here, and then you gone. Yeah. Cause one day you here, baby, and then you gone. One day you here, baby, and Ronnie Spencer's gone.
Let's go. Thank you guys for tuning in. You're watching Texas Underground.
Yeah, man.
Let's go.